Hi, everybody. I'm Rhoda Shermer. Thank you so much for joining us for our January program on the Supreme Court and Originalism. I'd like to thank our speakers, Jack Rakoff, Perry Dane, and Susan Herman, for participating. We really appreciate it. Thank you so much. Before I turn the program over to our speakers, I want to talk about the Q&A, and I want you to meet Lee Chinitz. There he is. Hi, Lee. Lee is going to monitor our Q&A, so please submit your questions throughout the program. And when we open the Q&A, Lee will be there having watched and waited for your questions, and he will field them to our speakers. So keep up the questions. We look forward to your questions because that's how we get even more information out that we need to understand. So at this point, I will start the program, and I'm not going to go into deep bios of each of our speakers. They are eminent professors, and their bios are on our website, but I'll introduce them in the order in which they will speak. So our first speaker is going to be Jack Rakoff, and he's a professor of history and political science at Stanford University. And our second speaker is Professor Perry Dane at Rutgers Law School. And our third speaker is Susan Herman, Brooklyn Law School. So I'm going to turn the program over to you, Jack, and then hope you'll turn the program over to the next speaker in their turn. So thank you so much again. We really appreciate your being here.
Great. Happy to be here on, you know, from the West Coast. But I'd like to say hello to everybody who's enjoying evening already. It's not quite sunset here. Let me start by saying something about my interest in the subject, which runs back a long way. I first started thinking about the question, what does it mean to talk about what the Constitution originally meant? What kind of a problem is that? I started thinking about that back in the early 1970s. When I was a graduate student doing my PhD in history at Harvard and following issues such as the impeachment of Richard Nixon, the debate over the War Powers Resolution, and a couple other related matters. And I found myself asking the question, as a historian, and at the time I was writing a dissertation on the Continental Congress, which of course is our first national government. So I was deeply versed in the history of the American Revolution and the development of, you know, forms of national politics and constitutional governance in the 1770s and 1780s. I started thinking about these questions because we had two or three hot controversies. The question of how whether or not and on what basis you could impeach and try Richard Nixon was, of course, a hot issue in 1973, 1974. At the same time, we had extensive debates coming out of the Vietnam War over the enactment of the War Powers Resolution of 1974, which was an attempt to put certain kinds of congressional limits on presidential discretion in terms of undertaking overseas conflicts. And also coincidentally, I was a U.S. Army reservist, clerk 71 Bravo 20, clerk typist, Sherborne all the way was our motto. And as a member of an organization called the Reservist Committee Against the War, run by a guy named Andy Stapp. And we had filed suit in federal district court in Washington against Secretary of Defense James Schlesinger. And the purpose of the suit was to say that every member of Congress who simultaneously held a commission in the military reserves had to resign one position or the other. You know, the Constitution prohibits members of Congress from holding office under the executive branch. And in terms of what the framers of the Constitution thought about the relationship between the executive branch and Congress, this was a very, the idea that you could be both, let's say, a major in the U.S. Marines or Army Reserves and a member of Congress was constitutionally problematic. So I had this set of issues. I was working on another subject, but I had a set of issues that I was thinking about. And it seemed to me at the time that to talk about what the Constitution originally meant was to ask a question that was inherently historical in its nature. And to answer that question, one should kind of come up with a method, a kind of model, a kind of, you know, program of research and analysis that would allow you to give some kind of answer to that question. I want to stress this point because when I start thinking about originalism, you know, the term originalism did not yet exist in the early 1970s. It was actually invented and actually developed by a Stanford colleague of mine, Paul Brest, in an article he published in the Boston University Law Review in 1980. So the term originalism did not yet exist, but the concept certainly did. And as I thought about it, it seemed to me, in the order of things, de rerum naturam, in the order of things, this was an inherently historical question. And it in turn led to some interesting questions about how do we think about the Constitution per se. I'll go on and say something more about my model in a minute or two. But let me juxtapose or maybe counterpose that view to a different view of how to talk about what the Constitution really meant. The dominant view of originalism which prevails today is not informed by history. It's not informed by the kind of work I would do or the kind of research, the kind of questions I would raise, the kind of research I would pursue if I were dealing with a question. Let's say, you know, for those who follow the Supreme Court, I actually did write a brief, or kind of the leading author of a brief that was recently filed in the Moore versus Harper case, was the independent state legislature case. Which involves, you know, whether the state legislatures have the sole authority to determine how, you know, rules of voting or issues of the times, places, and manner of congressional elections. But, you know, at the time I was thinking, you know, this is primarily a historical question that I was dealing with. Lawyers have a very different view, or I should say jurists and legal scholars have a very different view, it seems to me, of what originalism means. And in the current model of originalist interpretation, let's say the dominant model of originalist interpretation today, which is known as semantic or public meaning originalism, is essentially a linguistic exercise that history might help a bit here and there, but can rarely dispose. That's to say, historical material, the kind I deal with all the time, is can be informative in a general way, but it's unlikely to provide you with the answers you want to have. And I wanted to keep these two different models of constitutional thinking in mind because they actually represent two very different ways in which you and I, as both the citizens, but also as interested commentators or observers of constitutional law, may think about the constitutional text. So I set out back in the early 1970s. I actually didn't start working on this actively until the early 1980s because I had to finish my dissertation, get it published as a book, and do other things first, get tenure, and so on. But I started working on this early in the early 1980s, just when originalism became a hot issue in public discourse. There was a kind of famous exchange of views between Associate Justice Brennan and Ed Meese, in a sense a kind of Stanford colleague of mine through the Hoover Institution, about what was called a jurisprudence of original intention. So as I set out to formulate a model, a kind of, you know, a way of thinking analytically about how would you answer the question, what did the Constitution originally mean? I came up with kind of four basic categories of analysis. And I want to spend a couple minutes spelling out what those were. Our concern is always, if you're an originalist in any sense of the term, you're always concerned with the original meaning of the text. But how do you go about, you know, if a text is controversial, as it's almost inevitably bound to be, there's some question as to what exactly does this particular provision mean. So to become an originalist as a historian, you had to work out a model. So it seemed to me that model should have at least four parts. And let me briefly say what they were. You might be concerned, I would be concerned as a historian, this is where I would begin, with what I'll call the original intentions of the text authors. That's to say, the original intentions of the framers of the Constitution. So you start with James Madison's Notes of Debate from Philadelphia in 1787, and, you know, some other related documents. You know, some other delegates, you know, were taking somewhat limited notes of debate, and there are some other writings that reflect the framers' views, individual framers' views at the moments or during the period when the Constitution is being drafted. So you might want to start by talking about the original intentions of the framers. Or alternatively, I suppose I should say complementarily, you would also want to talk about the original understandings of the ratifiers. What I mean to say is we know that once the Constitution was drafted in Philadelphia, convention adjourned on September 17th, 1787, and the Constitution was first published 2 days later. It was submitted to all the states for ratification conventions, which went on into the summer of 1788. And we have a rich body of material. It's actually now about 35 published volumes, known as the Documentary History of the Ratification of the Constitution. So the ratifiers of the Constitution were not in any proper sense its authors, but they were all empowered readers, and their understanding of the nature of the text would also be a guide, would also be a clue, would also give you a set of sources to work with. There's an important point to be made here, because as a historian, I would say if I had to weigh these two sources, the intentions of the framers versus the understanding of the ratifiers, I would say the intentions of the framers would be more important to me. Why? Because they're the authors. You know, they're the ones saying that we're going to, for example, in the War Powers Clause, we're going to replace the phrase "make war." Congress has the power to make war with declare war. Significant difference between declaring war in terms of initiating it or authorizing it on the one hand, and making it in the sense of activity on the other. So, for example, you know, so we can do this with any of a number of other clauses. So I would think, as a working historian, you know, not a lawyer, just as a historian, that the original intentions of the framers would be somewhat more important than the original understandings of the ratifiers. But there's a problem with this model, if you think about this as a lawyer would, because the authority of the Constitution, and actually James Madison pointed this out going back to 1796, the legal authority, we could say the legal supremacy of the Constitution, came not from the Constitutional Convention per se. In Madison's words, the Constitution was just a dead letter when it left Philadelphia, until life was breathed into it by the ratifiers. So it's the approval of the ratifiers, you know, it's their understanding, in a sense, arguably, are legally more authoritative. Why? Because they actually have the constitutional responsibility to make the Constitution supreme law. So the first kind of, not conflict here, but the first kind of area of tension I'm setting up here is, one has to think about the determinations that led particular clauses to be adopted at Philadelphia between late May and mid-September 1787, on the one hand, and the way in which those clauses were interpreted and discussed by the ratifiers between September 1787 and, let's say, July 1788, which is effectively July, August 1788, which is when the debates over ratification effectively end. But beyond that, it seemed to me, again, as a working historian, there were two other sets of sources that would be relevant. The first would be kind of the general intellectual atmosphere within which the framers operated. So you'd want to know something about, you know, kind of the landmark texts in Western and particularly British political and constitutional thinking. You want to know about Hobbes and Locke, maybe go as far back as Machiavelli. You think about the Second Amendment, a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state. The concept of a free state is actually uno stato libero, is actually a Machiavellian concept. You want to say about Sir William Blackstone, his commentaries on the laws of England, and so on and so on. So there's a kind of intellectual background you'd also want to reconstruct. And then on the other hand, the framers were, after all, revolutionaries. They just passed through an intense decade or two decades, depending on, you know, which group of framers you look at, whether it's Roger Sherman, who was at the Stamp Act Congress in 1765, or James Madison, who entered politics really in 1776. You'd want to know something about their political experience. You'd want to know something about their policy concerns. So in a sense, in addition to what I call the two textual sources, the records of debate both from Philadelphia and then for the ratification period, you want to know something about two contextual sources, by which I mean, you know, both the intellectual legacy, which provided the framework within which Americans were debating and discussing, but also what were their working concerns. So that, for example, take another case, and a case I've worked actively on, if you're concerned about the Second Amendment, and I should say, I wrote a bit, you know, one of the things I'm proudest of having done in my career was having written the historian's brief in DC versus Heller, which is a great Second Amendment case from 2008. If you're a historian, you know, it's important to know and be able to say that, you know, when people talk about the right to bear arms, whether you say 77, 88, or 89, when the amendment was drafted, in 1791, by when it's ratified. It's critical to know that they were always talking about the militia and were never talking about a personal right of self-defense. And you know, that's, you could, I'm prepared to argue this point, to, you know, in my final years, literally until my last moments. So that's a way of thinking about this. And to me, when I think about originalism today, the problem with this is that although a lot of the legal scholars and about it, originalists are certainly familiar with and acquainted with the historical record, you know, the kinds of materials I've just been describing, they're not very happy working with them. They're not very comfortable. I think the reason for that is that, in a sense, is that history is messy. History is complicated. A lot of the issues that people discussed then were not matters that we're discussing now. In a sense, what historians are like to do is to kind of recover and restore a debate, you know, over particular clauses, particular problems, particular issues, particular provisions that was taking place in the late 1780s. We don't have to reach a final degree of certainty about what a particular clause meant. You know, we can present an array of views and suggest some views seem more authoritative than others. They're not all equally privileged, not all equally authoritative. They're not all equally, in a sense, binding or suggestive. You know, but we're happy describing a debate. If you're reasoning within the framework of litigation, constitutional litigation, there are results that you want to achieve. You are kind of committed to advancing and supporting a position. The kind of ambiguities that historians are perfectly comfortable with turn out to be messy and problematic if, in fact, you want to argue a case on one side or the other. So for that reason and others, most of the lawyers who are self-avowed originalists, though, you know, they're certainly not oblivious to the origins of the Constitution, they're not particularly interested in it either. And so what's first instead is what I called earlier is this theory of semantic or public meaning originalism, which means that the essential goal of being an originalist today, or the essential method of being an originalist today, is to come up with the one best linguistic understanding that would seem most authoritative. And the problem is, you know, there were no American dictionaries, you know, until after the Constitution was adopted. The very terms that Americans were disputing in the Constitution were terms that were themselves controversial. If you read the first sentence of Article 2, the executive power shall be vested in the President of the United States. The nature of the executive power is a not unambiguous term. What does it mean to have an establishment of religion? The religion clause, the opening clause of, you know, of the First Amendment. What do we mean by free exercise of religion? These were all problematic notions. But in any case, what legal lawyers want to do, precisely because history is messy and, you know, in problematic this way, they've developed a theory which most historians find deeply problematic, but says, no, what we really want to do is to think of the Constitution essentially as a legal text requiring authoritative interpretation of its language. The history might help, but there are other ways to do it. And the last thought I'll leave you with, and then I'll pass the baton to Perry, is that it seems to me as citizens, it's worth our while for us to ask, what view of the Constitution makes more sense to us? Do we think of it primarily as a legal text requiring an interpretation by judges and lawyers? Or should we not be sensitive to its political origins, characteristics, circumstances, the reasons why Americans at different periods got together to frame the Constitution and then to amend it, you know, often in significant ways, particularly after the Civil War? And I think that's a big normative question that I think is not adequately addressed in much of the literature. And for the West Coast, that's my wrap.
Well, thank you, Jack. That was really quite wonderful and brilliant, and a great account of how a serious historian thinks about constitutional meaning, and also at least an introduction to something that I'm going to talk a bit about, which is how that differs from this theory of original public meaning that has swept into the court. I mean, that's sort of been percolating for a while, but it has swept into the court with a vengeance in the last little while. So I'm going to take advantage of the technology, if you'll forgive me for that. And what I want to talk about is original public meaning. And as Rhoda said, I'm Perry Dane, and my dean would not forgive me if I didn't mention that I was professor of law at the Rutgers Law School. In fact, that is Rutgers Red. So here's the challenge. And it actually is a challenge for anyone reading any sort of text. We use words to communicate, but words don't necessarily speak for themselves, right? That seems obvious, but it turns out to be a profound and difficult problem. And I think it's also important to emphasize that different sorts of writings might require different methods of interpretation, different approaches to interpretation. So Jack talked about how a historian might look at a text versus how a lawyer might look at a text, but different texts themselves also call out for different sorts of methods. So just think in a common sense way, how do you read a poem? And how does that differ from how you read a novel? You know, you try to extract meaning from those words. How do you read a personal letter? How do you read scripture? Both Jews and Christians have traditionally emphasized that scripture has various layers of meaning. There's the plain sense, and there's the allegorical sense, and there's the mystical sense, right? And that's part and parcel of what it means in a serious way to read the Bible. How do you read a manual, right? We're about to get a new dishwasher, and I know that there's some controls that I'm going to need to adjust because my wife hates the beep that our old dishwasher sounded when it was done. So I'm going to have to look at the manual and see how to turn that off. So that would require, and that might not be entirely clear because these manuals are often written in a less than precise way. So how do you read a manual? How do you read recipes? Whether they're in books or things that get handed down to you, how do you read the Constitution? And I think one that's worth emphasizing is that different texts do call for different methods of interpretation. So it does seem to me that for some types of texts, we should really be very interested in the actual intent of the author, or what was going on in the brain of the author. Now, I actually do not think that that's true for constitutional texts, but I think it is true for some texts. This is a notorious example, right? And I'm not a doctor, so I can't swear to this, but I've read about this problem. A doctor prescribes 200 milligrams BID, and it turns out that can be read either 200 milligram tablets a day or two 100 milligram tablets a day. Now, ideally, there would be a standard understanding of what that term means. But at the end of the day, a nurse is really going to want to know what that particular doctor meant, or else the patient might die, right? So actual intent is important. Here's a somewhat less significant example, but one that I think we encounter all the time.
A quarter cup at a time. A thin stream. It's supposed to be a thin stream. Blend it really well, or you'll burn. David, that's not right.
Okay, well, that's because I'm ladling and stirring at the same time, and you're just standing there.
Now is not the time to lose focus, darling.
This was your idea. You're the one who allegedly made the enchiladas.
Yes, so try to keep up. Okay, next. Now's the time to sprinkle in the chili pepper flakes.
We've already done that.
What number are we on?
Oh, my God, is this not your mother's recipe?
Yes, and now I'm passing it on to you, so try to keep up. Next step is to fold in the cheese.
What does that mean? What does fold in the cheese mean?
He folds it in.
I understand that, but how do you fold it? Do you fold it in half like a piece of paper and drop it in the pot, or what do?
David, I cannot show you everything.
Okay, well, can you show me one thing?
You just, here's what you do. You just fold it in.
Okay, I don't know how to fold broken cheese like that.
And I don't know how to be any clearer. You take that thing that's in your hand. And you...
If you say fold in one more time...
It says fold it in!
This is your recipe. You fold in the cheese then.
Don't you dare.
You fold it in.
David! Oh, good. Now I see bubbles. David! What does burning smell like?
Okay. So what makes this funny, right? What makes this funny is that this is a recipe that was handed down from David's grandmother to his mother, to David. And he sort of has this intuition that this idea of folding in the cheese is less clear than it seems. And ideally, he'd want to ask his grandmother. His grandmother isn't around. He asks his mother, and she doesn't want to admit that she doesn't know what her mother thought. But it's clearly crucial, right? So when reading that sort of text, right, it really helps to know what the original thing going on in the head of the author was. Now, for much of his history, and here I do have to disagree a little bit with Jack, because I do come at this as a lawyer, right? And as lawyers, we do have to read these texts to ultimately reach conclusions about specific questions. And that's what the Supreme Court has been doing since the beginning and other courts. But for much of its history, the Supreme Court read the Constitution through a combination of methods, right? You know, very eclectic, very sort of an organized disorder, a hodgepodge of methods that in some sense came together to produce this history of jurisprudence. And one of those methods was original intentions. It always has been. But never the exclusive method. And that's partly because the Constitution is not a recipe. It's not a recipe, it's a legal enactment. And one of the things that people interested in legal texts have said for a long time is that legal enactments have a power all their own. In that sense, they're sort of like poetry, right? A poem, once it's published, is no longer in the control of its author. When Shakespeare wrote To Be or Not to Be in Hamlet, he, in a sense, doesn't get to decide whether that's about suicide or murder or existential angst or piety or impiety, right? That's part of our job as readers. Oliver Wendell Holmes famously said, we do not inquire what the legislature meant. We ask only what the statute means. So original intentions are relevant to legal meaning, but it's rarely been thought that they're entirely dispositive of it. So what else? There's structure. You know, how do different, some people who think about the Constitution have tried to think pretty deeply about how the different parts of the Constitution fit together, what their relationship is to each other. There's historical context, which Jack has, again, brilliantly told us more about. There's legal background. Like how do these legal texts in the Constitution relate to other legal texts that might have preceded them? That's another very productive way, very often, about thinking about constitutional meaning. And it's related to history, but it's not the same thing as history. There's moral coherence, right? There are people on both the left and the right. This is not necessarily, I mean, we tend to think of some of these debates as being ultimately political, but there are people both on the left and the right over time who thought that the Constitution has to be read with the assumption that it makes moral sense. And that might be despite the intentions of the authors, that might be despite some of the history. Again, there are people from very different ideological points of view who've argued that the Constitution has to be read as a moral document. Or rather that its legal meaning has to make some moral sense. And then there's the view, right? There's the view which is now very much on the outs, at least in some quarters, but which has long been an important part of how the Supreme Court proceeded in thinking about the constitutional text. There's the view that reading the Constitution requires that we not only look to the past, whether it's the legal past or the historical past, but that we also keep in mind that the Constitution often prompts us, often gives us the opening to an evolving understanding of justice and rights. And that's especially true for the Constitution's most general and majestic provisions. There are provisions in the Constitution that are very specific. There's no evolving understanding of the requirement that the president be 35 years old. But there might be an evolving understanding of equal protection. There might be evolving understanding of due process. There are certain clauses in the Constitution that at least some justices and lawyers and academics over the years have thought scream out for our contemporary perspective. So my one-time boss, who Jack mentioned at one point, who is famous for taking that view of certain clauses of the Constitution. But by the way, he could also be a historian when he needed to be, and he could be an intentionalist, sometimes was. But at least with respect to some parts of the Constitution, he wrote that the genius of the Constitution rests not in any static meaning it might have had in a world that is dead and gone, but in the adaptability of its great principles to cope with current problems and current needs. So there are all of these different methods that have been part of the mix of constitutional understanding over the years. It's important to emphasize that what we've seen recently is a fairly new phenomenon. It's this new phenomenon of sort of trying to find the key. You know, rather than sort of just slogging through the lawyer's work of using a variety of methods and debating and arguing and going back and forth, there's been this attraction to the idea that we could just find the key to constitutional meaning, then we're home free. So sort of if there's some method that will just solve everything. The idea that there's some method that will just solve everything, that's a fairly new idea. And it's what's led us to our current position, it seems to me. So there was the first wave of originalism, the one that Paul Brest was responding to in the article that Jack cited. And the first wave of originalism did focus on original intentions. But for a variety of reasons, and Justice Holmes has been an authority on that as anybody, but there are other reasons as well. For a variety of reasons, just trying to reduce the meaning of the text to the original intentions of the authors doesn't work jurisprudentially. That's why constitutions are not the same as recipes for enchiladas. Right? It might be that the best way to understand a recipe for an enchilada is to know what your grandmother meant when she said fold in the cheese. But there are sort of good legal reasons for thinking that's not the best way to understand a constitution, which is, after all, an enacted text. It's not just a written text. It's an enacted text. So in the light of what everyone recognized were a variety of problems with a sort of intentionalism that focused on what was going on in the authors' heads, there was a second wave of originalism, which has simmered for a while, but has recently become orthodox among many members of the current court. And that looks not to the original intent of the authors, but as Jack said, to the original public meaning of the text. So this theory of original public meaning claims that constitutional provision should be interpreted as they would have been understood by the original public. And again, it's a semantic inquiry, right? And again, I'm agreeing with Jack, right? But we need to ask, how would the original public have understood these words? And this approach is actually quite new, especially in sort of uncompromising form. There are various problems with it. I just want to focus on one, or at least hint at one problem with this view. Because again, the view is this is the key, this is the magic bullet that will solve all our problems with constitutional, with debate over constitutional meaning. Just look to the original public. Just look to the original public. Here's one problem, in a nutshell. The problem is, how do we interpret a new constitutional provision? Imagine a brand new constitutional provision. Imagine we are the original public. That's not entirely unstable. In 2018, New Hampshire enacted this new provision in its constitution. And the individual's right to live free from governmental intrusion and private or personal information is natural, essential, and inherent. What the hell does that mean? It's up to us, or at least not me, because I don't live in New Hampshire, but it's up to the lawyers and judges in New Hampshire to figure out what that means. And the one thing they cannot do is look to the original public meaning. And why can they not look to the original public meaning? Because they're the original public, right? They have to figure out what it means as best they can through some combination of methods, the way lawyers have always done it. The one thing they cannot do is look to the original public meaning. And why is that significant? It's significant because it means that we are equipped to figure out constitutional meaning. If we're equipped to do that when we're the original public, that means we have a toolkit. And for reasons I can go into further in the Q&A, it seems to me that we should feel free to use exactly that same toolkit when we look at legal texts. That we can engage in an argument with the original public, because we're just not in all cases, but in most cases, perfectly entitled to enter into a debate with them about what the meaning of the text would be. So that's sort of my brief effort to situate this new theory of original public meaning, and also to give you a bit of a critique of it. So I'm going to pass the baton to Susan then.
Well, thank you, Perry, and thank you, Jack, for some very rich history. I think what both of you are saying is that there are a lot of different ways to be an originalist. And I was thinking when Elena Kagan was nominated to be on the Supreme Court at her Senate confirmation hearing, when asked was she an originalist, she said, "We're all originalists." And I think when you think about it, you know, there's really a lot to that. One of my favorite descriptions, which kind of overlaps with Jack's categories, is Ronald Dworkin said that the question really is, at what level of generality are you going to be an originalist? So I want to talk about the first case that I gave my constitutional law students to think about originalism as an example of what that means. And that case is a 1928 case called Olmsted versus United States. And what was happening in that case was that the federal agents were investigating Roy Olmsted to see if he had been involved in a conspiracy to violate the Prohibition Act. And they did that by wiretapping his telephone and getting all this evidence of what he had said in his telephone conversations. So Olmsted claimed that the government should not be allowed to use that evidence because they hadn't gotten a warrant, and therefore they had violated his rights under the Fourth Amendment, which says that the people have a right to be secure against unreasonable searches and seizures in their persons, houses, papers, and effects. Well, a majority of the court in 1928 looked at his claim and said, no, telephone wiretapping isn't covered by the Fourth Amendment. And the reason for that is that if you had asked the framers whether they intended to cover telephone wiretapping, they wouldn't have thought that. What they thought at the time, what they thought they were covering with the language of searches and seizures and persons, houses, papers, and effects, those only covered physical intrusions. Like if somebody broke down the door of your house and searched, you know, looked in your desk to see if Benjamin Franklin had any seditious papers there, or if somebody physically takes you and arrests you. So that was a very highly semantic opinion, just looking at the words and looking what the understanding of the words would have been in the 18th century when people didn't know what a telephone was. So by far the more famous opinion now is the dissent in the Olmsted case, which is by Louis Brandeis. And Brandeis said, we shouldn't interpret the words of the Constitution according to the very particular and narrow conception of what the framers were talking about. As Perry said, they used a lot of majestic open-ended phrases like unreasonable search and seizure, due process, cruel and unusual punishment. And what those phrases seemed to mean was that they were not trying to give us a list of what was and was not okay. They were trying to allow room for succeeding generations to let the Constitution evolve. So what Brandeis said is he said when he looks at the Constitution, what he was referring to are more Jack's categories 3 and 4. What are the framers worried about? What, you know, the Fourth Amendment actually represents a lot of the framers' concerns that led to the revolution. They were very hated the idea that they were being constantly subjected to searches by agents of the crown of their desks to see if they had seditious literature, of their basements to see if they had, you know, rum on which they hadn't paid the customs duty. And arbitrary search and seizure was something that was very important to them. So what Brandeis said is he said the Constitution actually does not only protect what's in these particular words, because what it really protects is a right to be let alone. And the value that the framers were trying to protect was a right of privacy. So I think that Brandeis was being an originalist in a different way from the majority, because I think what he was assuming was that if you could somehow, as in those games, you could bring Madison back and have lunch with him, and you could say to him, hey, let me explain to you what a telephone is. Now, let me tell you what wiretapping is. Is that the kind of thing you guys had in mind when you wrote the Fourth Amendment? And Brandeis is saying he would have said yes. And therefore, it's inconsistent with the whole idea of the Constitution and all its majestic open-ended phrases to say that we are pinned to what the particular evils that the framers could imagine. Brandeis said, and I thought this was quite uncanny, it's like in 1928, he foresaw the cell phone. He said, ways may someday be developed by which the government, without removing papers from secret drawers, can reproduce them in court. So I relied very heavily on the Olmsted brief, on the Olmsted decision, and on an 18th century English case about searching people's desks when I wrote a brief for the ACLU in the Supreme Court's case of Riley versus California, which was about whether or not police, when they arrest somebody, can automatically open up their cell phones and search whatever is in the cell phones. You look at everything in the phone incident to arrest. And what I said is, you know, these days, a cell phone is your home. It's Benjamin Franklin's desk. It's where we keep our secret papers. And Brandeis foresaw that the things that the framers objected to, like these governmental intrusions on privacy and trying to intrude on people's private thoughts and domains, those intrusions are just going to happen in different ways in the future. So to me, this whole idea of the level of generality, I think, is much more Jack's categories 3 and 4. And one of the problems that I have with the original public meaning is that, as Jack is saying, there are all these different sources there, and people are constantly cherry picking the sources. So you see in the, there's a Second Amendment opinion that the Supreme Court wrote in 2008, the Heller opinion, where the question was, does the Second Amendment actually guarantee people an individual right to bear arms, or is it really about the ability of people to participate in a militia? So Justice Scalia has all of his dictionaries and all his concrete sources that absolutely tell you exactly what those words undeniably would have meant to the, you know, the framers and ratifiers. And then Justice Stevens, in his dissent, it's a 5-4 opinion, Justice Stevens comes up with a completely opposing set of sources. And so he's picked the sources that say the opposite thing, since, as Jack is saying, constitutional litigators want to win, but Supreme Court justices also want to win. And so it's very rare to find a Supreme Court opinion that really does good and complete history, because everybody's picking out the aspect of the things in all of Jack's four categories that support what they mean. So where I want to go from there is I want to talk about the Dobbs case last term, where the Supreme Court overruled Roe v. Wade. And to me, the Dobbs opinion, the majority opinion, is a lot like the majority opinion in Olmsted. It's highly semantic, and it has this very narrow view of history. So what Justice Alito says is, he says, well, Roe was obviously wrong about whether there's a fundamental constitutional right to abortion. And the reasons for that are two. Number one, the word abortion does not appear in the Constitution. Just like, you know, telephone wiretapping didn't appear in the Constitution. You know, that wasn't what they were thinking about. Number two, if you look at history, history shows, and then he talks, and I think his history was not very good. And as I understood it, I think there actually was not prohibition of abortion until the 19th century. But, you know, that's a different matter. But what I want to say is that by taking those approaches, you can see him putting the rabbit into the hat. Why is it that abortion was not included in the Constitution? Well, one thing you could say is that the original Constitution was only written to bind the federal government. It was not written to apply to the states. Nobody could have imagined, I think, in the 18th century that the federal government was ever going to find a way to even think they could find a way to prevent women from getting abortions. So, yeah, it's not until the 19th century that the Constitution starts applying to the states where the question even comes up. Justice Rehnquist, who dissented in Roe v. Wade, said that he was dissenting because by the 19th century, when the 14th Amendment was passed, there were, in fact, states had a lot of laws criminalizing abortion. Okay, so there's a second reason, I think, why there's no guarantee of reproductive freedom on the face of the Constitution. And this is my deepest objection to original public meaning, originalism, this sort of narrow semantic, you're always focusing on what did the framers and ratifiers mean by those words, what did they understand by those words. And my objection is, who are the framers and ratifiers of the Constitution in the 18th century? And who are they not? Who were the framers and ratifiers of the 14th Amendment in the 19th century, and who were there not? There were no women. If there had been women involved in drafting the original Constitution, it is possible that they might have thought about reproductive freedom. So to me, when you're using this very narrow version of history and really examining the words, what were the particular evils that the framers of the Constitution were trying to prevent, as opposed to what is this majestic general principle of liberty and, you know, and due process? What you're doing is you're being deeply regressive. And what I think the current court is doing by having a majority of justices who subscribe to this narrow view of history, did the framers think that telephone wiretapping was included? Did the framers think that abortion should be a right? What you're doing is you are erasing the democratization of our country. It's not until 1870 that the Constitution prohibited not letting people vote on the basis of race, color, or previous condition of servitude. And it's not until 1920 that the states are prohibited from not allowing women to vote. So we talk about citizens. Who are the citizens? Well, the citizens today are a much broader group than they were in either the 18th or 19th century. So that's one real problem that I have with what the Supreme Court is doing. I think that it really entrenches this very narrow view, which turns out to be, you know, fairly misogynistic, and also very often has consequences in terms of race. The second thing that I want to say about this original public meaning originalism is that I think it's a highly arrogant and authoritative approach to the Constitution. I know what that word means, and nobody else does. You know, as you were saying, a magic bullet. This is it. That's the correct way. Well, the claim, the defense of that kind of originalism is that it's an important thing to constrain judges who would otherwise be subjective. So if I look at the Due Process Clause, I might think that it guarantees a right to abortion or a right to a hearing in a certain circumstance. Perry might think a different thing. Jack might think a third thing. So the claim of originalists, the claim of Justice Scalia, was that originalism is meant to tie the judges to the mast, regardless of what they might think on the merits. They have to follow what the words say and what the Constitution was meant to mean. So the whole idea that this is objective, it's a constraint, and it prevents people from being subjective. Well, Sandra Day O'Connor, who was the first woman on the court, had a very different approach. And in the case of Planned Parenthood versus Casey in 1992, when the court was first asked the question of whether or not they should overrule Roe v. Wade, when it was really expected that they probably would, O'Connor referred to this originalist, the original plain meaning approach that Scalia was pushing in his dissent in that case. And I thought this word was so interesting. She referred to that theory as tempting. I think that's such an easy, interesting thought that she, as a conservative justice, was tempted by the idea that she could just tell exactly what the Constitution means and just say Roe v. Wade was wrong. But instead, the approach that O'Connor took in Planned Parenthood versus Casey was a stare decisis approach. And what she said is, it's not just me up here saying what I think. Do I think Roe v. Wade was right or wrong or horribly wrong, or what do I think? She said, I've become a member of the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court is an institution. And I should not be overturning the work of my colleagues in earlier days just because I think they were wrong. I should only be doing that. I should only be overruling a case if I think that things have really changed. And then she sort of tries to articulate some factors that you would look at to explain why it was in fact a good idea for Brown versus Board of Education to overrule Plessy versus Ferguson. Now, to me, it's sort of like she was saying, you know, when you join the Supreme Court, it's like you're entering a river and you go with the current of the river and you don't fight unless there's a really, really good reason to. And that, I think, is a much more attractive version of how a Supreme Court justice or any judge could constrain themselves and feel that they're not just being subjective and saying whatever they think the Constitution, what they want the Constitution to mean. So it's an approach that I would prefer. The final thing that I want to say about the original public meaning, which I think we've all already alluded to in some ways, is that I think that it is really a deeply indeterminate approach. So in addition to some of the examples that have already been given, one very interesting argument that I've heard about the Dobbs case was that one reason why the Supreme Court was wrong about whether or not abortion is a fundamental right is that when the 14th Amendment was adopted after the Civil War, some of the abolitionists who were supporting the idea of the 14th Amendment were not only concerned about freeing the slaves and about restoring some sort of civil liberty to people who had been enslaved. That's sort of the typical view of, you know, only thinking of the men who were laboring in the fields. Well, my friend Michelle Goodwin said that some of those abolitionists very specifically intended the 14th Amendment with its equal protection clause and its due process clause to reverse what had been happening to women who were in slavery, who had no reproductive freedom, who were subject to rape, who were subject to having their children taken away. And so I find that a deeply attractive argument. I was very pleased when I was writing the brief in the cell phone case to be able to rely on, you know, yellowing English cases, you know, from the deep library from the 18th century to say what we're doing with cell phones is the same thing. So I thought Michelle Goodwin's argument is very interesting and very attractive. But then I pause and I say to myself, but wait a minute, you know, how many of the people who were drafting the 14th Amendment were thinking about that? How many of the people who are ratifying the 14th Amendment were thinking about that? How many people does it have to be? And isn't this just, you know, an opportunity for cherry picking? So I'm sort of like, you know, I think where I would like to, you know, end, I just wanted to introduce those two cases and a few of those concepts. They claim that original public meaning originalism, because it is, you know, confined to the words. It's just, yeah, and Alito would tell you that I'm just doing what the words say. The majority in Olmsted would have said that we're just doing what the words say. You know, that's not a good answer to me. First of all, you know, it's too indeterminate. You know, you kind of made up the answer around that. But you know, more importantly, I feel like there's just something so deeply regressive about this. So I wanted to ask both of you, Perry and Jack, there are a couple of questions that I would love to hear your thoughts about. One of which is whether the majority of the court's current approach, their kind of semantic approach to original public meaning, could that approach pass the original public meaning test? Is that in fact what the framers and ratifiers of the Constitution would have expected? And then my second question, if you want to talk about this too, is originalism is being used these days as if it really has a political valence, as if it's just conservative. What do you think about the idea of a progressive originalism? Okay, to you, whichever of those questions you want to talk about.
I'll lead off if that's okay with you. So, you know, as to the first question, usually I explain this to my students who are primarily although I'm retired now, but primarily Stanford graduates. One of the arguments I want to make is constitutional law itself, in the sense in which we think about it, was also something being invented in late 18th, early 19th century America. I disagree with the idea that I think many law professors still teach that until you get to Marbury versus Madison, the famous case of 1803, judicial review was just this abstract, nebulous idea. I think by the 1780s, there's ample historical, and even at the Constitutional Convention, there's ample evidence that the framers understood courts would have this important function of constitutional interpretation. But to say they would have that function is not the same thing as saying you would know or understand what the nature of constitutional argumentation was. The idea of a written constitution as supreme fundamental law sustained by the popular ratification expressed in the conventions of 1787-88, that by itself was a departure. In British, you know, in the British tradition from which Americans emerge, the final source of law, I mean, it's true there are law judges, I suppose, in the House of Lords, but, you know, Parliament is the supreme source of law. And the Americans set up the idea of a written constitution, a supreme fundamental law, as an alternative to the principle of parliamentary supremacy. So if you just, if you, again, if you think about this historically, meaning, you know, you want to be careful about tracking the different, of historical knowledge, you want to be careful about tracking the different phases in the development of a concept or practice. The idea that you would have one theory of constitutional interpretation that would be preeminent, you know, and there was there ab initio from the very beginning is itself nonsense. Now, there is a sequel to this, which is James Madison gives a famous speech on April 6, 1796, during the debates over the Jay Treaty, and I won't get into the politics here, but it goes back to, you know, the little passage I quoted earlier. He says the Constitution, as it came from the convention, was just a dead letter until life and spirit were breathed into it by the people through the ratification conventions. So in that sense, Madison comes down on the side of what I would call original understanding as opposed to original intention. Though a few years earlier, when they talk about necessary and proper back in 1791, he's also an original intentionalist. The key thing to understand here is that constitutional law was by its nature dynamic. It was, I think, you know, in the way in which Americans think about it, it was an innovation. And its aspects, its implications, its complications, its nuances, its problems, all remain to be discovered in practice. So to have an excessive degree of confidence in what the whole enterprise entailed, and to posit or stipulate that that was there from the very beginning strikes me as being historically nonsensical. That was just the first question. I forgot what the second one was. Yeah,
maybe Perry has thoughts about the first question, and then I'll give you the second one again. Perry, what do you think? Could the originalism theories pass the originalism test?
No, of course not. I mean, there was a famous article written, I think in the 80s, and I'm trying to remember the precise title, but it was something like the original intent of original intent, or the original meaning of original meaning, something to that effect. By Jefferson Powell, and his observation was that the way lawyers and judges read the Constitution in the early days was not to delve into the psychological intent of the framers. They often spoke of intent in a more abstract way, but they didn't mean what some modern intentionalists mean. And the same argument, right? The same argument can certainly be made with respect to this more newfangled notion of original public meaning. Now whether that should dispose of the debate is another question, or whether it's just a sort of gotcha point. I'm not sure of that. But in any event, it's certainly an interesting. An important observation. And we do know that in the earliest constitutional debates, which didn't necessarily occur in court, but did occur among legally trained and legally sophisticated folks, they used a wide variety of arguments. One of the earliest, most famous debates was about whether George Washington had the right to abrogate the treaty with the French and declare neutrality. And this is actually, surprisingly, my students know all about this debate in con law because it plays a prominent role in Hamilton, right? So there's a whole rap version of it. Which doesn't really get into the legal arguments, unfortunately. But in any event, if you do get into the legal arguments, they're about theories of executive authority. They're about sort of careful parsing of the language. They're about, you know, three or four or five or six different modalities that each side brings to their position. And none of them is simply saying, let's look to the original public, because after all, as I said, they were the original public. And as the original public, they were engaged in a debate. And it's the same debate that that we can engage in. As to the political valence of all this, so I sort of have mixed feelings about the extent to which we should be thinking about the politics of it. Clearly, both original intent and then original public meaning were the product of a political movement, right? So it's not surprising that it should be the, quote, conservatives on the court who are most committed to those positions. But it didn't have to be that way, right? You can imagine a different American history in which it would have been more liberal justices who would have somehow latched on to some version of original public meaning. And certainly now you have somebody like Justice Jackson, who in a sort of very brilliant and powerful way is saying, okay, I can be an originalist too. And here's, you know, and here's the part of the original public meaning that you're ignoring. And she does that very effectively. It's also worth pointing out that just like original public meaning could in principle be either liberal or conservative, critiques of original public meaning can be either liberal or conservative. So if you think that liberals are upset about Dobbs, you should read some of the folks who espouse a fairly new but fascinating theory of constitutional interpretation called common good constitutionalism. So these are people who very much take the view that the Constitution needs to embody essential moral principles. Not unlike what, you know, what my boss, Justice Brennan, would have said. But the moral principles they have in mind are very different than the ones that you would have had in mind. And they see Dobbs as a failure, right? They see Dobbs as a failure because it committed the court to being neutral on the question of abortion. They see Dobbs as a failure because Justice Kavanaugh, in a concurrence, wrote something that seems to have sort of committed the court to saying, don't worry, folks. Yes, states have the right to ban abortion. But on the other hand, the fetus itself doesn't have a constitutional right to personhood that we're going to enforce. Right? We at the Supreme Court are going to be entirely neutral on this. So you have these very conservative people who are saying that is a failure of originalism. Right? It's originalism run amok in this terrible, immoral way. And they're just as convinced of that and just as vehement about it as the liberal critique, as the liberal critics of Dobbs from the other side. So yes, there is a politics, there's a political history to what's going on, but it's also a bit of an accidental political history. And we shouldn't think that these various theories automatically fall into one category, one political category or another.
Well, I take your point that if you're talking about reading the Constitution in terms of values, Michael Perry used to talk about this a lot, about, you know, the kind of a moral constitution, the Constitution being the best it can be, that you know, what goes around can come around, and you know, it could be rights of fetuses as well as the right to have an abortion. But what about, you know, the point that I was making, it seems to me that the current court's choice of this particular theory, you know, the Scalia prudence here, is very much tied to the idea of putting us back into the 18th or 19th century and entrenching values of that time in a way that really continued to treat women as second-class citizens. And the whole idea that, you know, that this narrow view of history, going back to when all, I want to repeat this again, all of the framers and ratifiers in both the 18th and 19th centuries were men. Okay, so if you go back to that, you're leaving out, you know, so many of the people who are the citizens today. So does AI, I think Lee probably wants to go to questions from the audience. Can you comment on that? Or?
Well, I'll just make one quick observation.
Terry, go ahead.
I'll make one quick observation. Actually, I have an article coming out on original public meaning, originalism, that goes through some of this. But one of the differences between original public meaning and intentionalism is that, at least in principle, it looks to the views not of those men who wrote the Constitution and not of the ratifiers. It looks to the views of the, quote, original public. And one of these days, it hasn't happened yet, right? But one of these days, somebody's going to point out that among the members of the original public, right, which is to say the people who might have read the Constitution and had a view of it, or the people who might have used the words that are used in the Constitution, however precisely you define original public meaning, one of these days somebody's going to point out that among those people, right, not among the authors or the ratifiers, but among those people, were a whole bunch of women, right, and a whole bunch of enslaved persons who at least would have heard something about the Constitution. I mean, we know with respect to the Declaration of Independence, it was very quickly taken up as an abolitionist document, right, despite the fact that Thomas Jefferson owned slaves. So one of these days, somebody's going to think seriously about what it means to look to the views of the entire original public. That you're right, that hasn't happened yet.
I could just ask that, Perry, how do we find out what those people think? Would the slaves weren't allowed to read or write. The women were not writing books.
One of these days, somebody's going to think about that in a more serious way. It's not going to be me, because I don't buy the theory. Right? But one of these
To my way of thinking, the idea that there is an original public meaning that is independent of a known body of sources is itself kind of a myth. You know, that's to say, you have, of course, that's the historian's responsibility. Every statement we make, you have to be able to run back to a text. You know, if texts don't exist, you could do a lot of surmising, or you have to look further and see what else you come up with. But you have to work within a finite body of sources. And so the original public meaning to me is a kind of, you know, it's really a modern judicial invention, which stipulates the existence. You know, it's not about really existing people. It's a legal fiction of a certain kind. Susan, I want to come back to your question about, is there a progressive form of originalism? That was the second question. Mm-hmm. So I happen to think there is. I mean, you know, I usually identify myself as a native Cook County Democrat. You know, my family actually had ties to the original Daily Machine. My dad wrote a couple of famous books about the first Mayor Daley. So I don't know if I count myself as, you know, as a true hard left progressive, though my first job after I got out of the Army in 1969 was working for the ACLU in Chicago. So yeah, I had that credential as well. But I have written been the main author or sole author of 5 amicus curiae briefs for the Supreme Court. 3 on apportionment cases, you know, Viva versus Jubilier, Arizona redistricting, and then now the, you know, the recent one, the Moore versus Harper. I did a brief, Neil Katyal asked me to do a brief in the military, Hamdan versus Rumsfeld. And the one I mentioned before, you know, I did the brief in DC versus Heller. I mean, again, I was the main author, I recruited some colleagues, but decided in the end, you know, a brief in the end should have a final author. And, you know, and that was me. And I know actually from Kate Shaw, who was, I think, clerking for Stevens at that point. I know that Stevens followed, you know, in his dissent. I know that Stevens followed my brief pretty closely. I know that Arizona redistricting, so that was an L, that was a loss. Arizona redistricting was a W. And I know because the student I was clerking for RBG that term, she's now at Wachtell, but you know, I know RBG, the critical parts of her decision, the Arizona redistricting, which is a case, you know, for the listeners, it's a case involving whether or not, you know, via the initiative process, you know, the voters of Arizona could set up a nonpartisan redistricting commission. So, you know, I happen to think, two things. I mean, you follow the evidence where it takes you. It varies with the issue. And if you know the sources well, and you've learned to kind of reason and think as lawyers do, You can be a progressive originalist. I mean, same thing would be true. I mean, take the, I don't, God knows what's going to happen in the affirmative action case, but it's, as soon as you start with the existence, I think this is what Justice Jackson was getting at. Once you start with the existence of the Freedmen's Bureau, you know, during Reconstruction, it's not that big a problem, you know, to say. The other thing I want to say as a scholar is, you know, just because as a kind of matter of honor or professional stature and reputation, you don't want to be a constitutional hooker. It's the phrase I usually use. You know, you want your brief to be consistent with your scholarship. And you know, if you come down on one side in terms of your preferences, but the scholarship carries you somewhere else, you know, maybe you should just withdraw rather than embarrass oneself. I mean, you know, I do think those of us who take our scholarship seriously, cherish our reputations. And so it's a, you know, would be a mistake to just do, I think what lawyers, you know, actually have to do, you know, what's in your client's interest, and you follow accordingly. But, you know, but I happen to think, you know, you have to look carefully at the issues. And in fact, you know, and if you're a good historian and you know the source as well, you may well come up with a much more compelling story. That if it won't be persuasive, since the first rule of Supreme Court of litigation is, can you count to five? Nevertheless, you may constrain the basis of debate, or you may open up avenues for subsequent criticism.
Yeah, so with that, let me take some of the questions that have been written and also sent in ahead of time. Here's one, Alice Smith sent this in actually before this session. I think it's probably one that a lot of people who don't, you know, who aren't lawyers would kind of wonder about. I mean, if you're an originalist, I mean, what do you make of amendments to the Constitution in the first place? I'm assuming she means, you know, beyond the Bill of Rights. I mean, the fact that, well, anyway, that's how she phrased the question. So how would you respond to that?
Well, if you're an originalist, you know, if you're a strong originalist, you believe in amendments a lot. I mean, rather than, you know, I mean, the preferred, you know, I think the standard line would be the preferred mode of constitutional change, mm-hmm. is the amendment process. So that's one point. Second point is the other problem here is, and you know, it's a big problem. And I think it's, you know, if you think about the all the voting rights cases, going Shelby and its antecedent successors, combined, you know, we've had two foundings in this nation. In effect, you know, one in the 1780s and a second in the 1860s. And integrating the two has been a major challenge and a major problem for conservatives. And the affirmative action case will probably demonstrate this. The voting rights case manifestly do that.
So she had a second part of the question, which is kind of repeated by a couple of people who wrote in. The way she said it was, you know, so since in 1789, there was no atomic energy, no air travel, you know, how do you handle that in the context of originalism? You know, Marie, you know, Hens Elder Kimmel wrote in, how do proponents of originalism explain that the original public meaning was not the understanding as continued from 1787 ratification through the next 230 years? I just think it's a sort of a general question that people would have, you know, that, and I'll layer this maybe on top of it. You know, in what other field of knowledge would it even be reasonable to limit yourself to the views of, you know, some time in the past and say that, you know, from that point on, you know, you have to look back to that point in the past? Like, you wouldn't do that in chemistry, right? Or, you know, medicine, right? So why does it even make any sense? I mean, just like in the basic sense, like, why does it make sense?
I'll start on that. So there was recently an article in the Washington Post that was entitled "Originalism is Bunk," and you know, we shouldn't fall for it. And to me, the whole original public, what you were just saying, Jack, about you could be a progressive originalist by looking at history. Well, that's more than the semantic approach. You know, we're looking at the words and what would somebody have thought that word, you know, did that word mean telephone wiretapping? Did that word mean abortion? Yeah, if you're doing better history than that, then you know, it's quite different. But I think that, to me, the whole claim that original public meaning is objective and a constraint is ridiculous, because you watch Justice Scalia, who had no problem saying, of course, First Amendment freedom of expression applies on the internet. Mm-hmm. And in the Second Amendment, when people said, okay, so you have a right to carry a musket, right? And he said, oh, no, of course not. That would be ridiculous. You have the right to carry modern weapons. So I think it's just, I think it's bad history. I think maybe judges shouldn't be historians, or mm-hmm. pretend to be historians. If that's what they're thinking of doing, they should at least, find real historians to make those decisions. But I think that it's completely inconsistent. It all seems to be very result-oriented. So I think that there are better ways. To me, the whole idea of going back to the, first of all, to go back to the principles, more Jack's second and third and fourth categories, what were they thinking about? Not just the words that they used, but what were the kinds of problems they were worried about? And isn't telephone wiretapping the same kind of thing as opening up Benjamin Franklin's desk?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, there's the argument that the Air Force may be unconstitutional. Oh, no, it's worth right. speculating, but no one takes it seriously. I would say, the planes you have to take off and they have to, they have to land. Maybe the Space Force. I don't know. But it's kind of.
I'm not an originalist, and I think I've made that clear. But it might be worth trying to channel the originalists just for a minute to respond to these questions. So with respect to. To why we should pay attention to a document written in 1787. I think the answer they would give is that's the whole point of having a written constitution, that we bind ourselves and we bind courts, and we reserve the power through a certain procedure to change the rules of the game, but until we do that, the rules of the game are what they are, and it's different from chemistry, right? Because in chemistry, what we're trying to make sense of is not an enacted text; it's a fact of the universe, right? And it's a current fact of the universe. But in law. Right, when what we're trying to make sense of is the meaning of this enacted text, and if it's a text like the Constitution, which prevails over other sorts of legal texts, then what the originalists would say is, if you can have a written constitution, and if it's really binding, and if you empower courts to enforce it, then they better enforce the Constitution and not some imaginary update of it.
Yeah.
And I'm not an originalist. I think that's oversimplified, mm-hmm. but I think it's at least an argument that we shouldn't dismiss out of hand. With respect to the musket problem, there I think the originalists actually have it a little easier. Because their response is actually quite sensible, right? Their response is, sure, there are ways in which the world has changed, and we have to use one or another method to apply the sorts of rules and the sorts of principles and the sorts of meanings that we've discovered through originalism and apply them to these changed circumstances. And we can do it by analogy, we can do it by abstraction. It's not rocket science, to coin a term, but we can do it. And it doesn't require updating the values. And it doesn't even require updating the sort of semantic rules or the semantic conclusions that we've come to realize that sometimes you have to translate those terms into a way that can then be used in a modern technological context. And of course, it's not just constitutional lawyers who need to do that. Religious systems have to do that all the time, right? If you're an observant Jew, you have a directive not to light fire on the Sabbath. Well, what does that say about electricity, right? Rabbis have been debating that since electricity began to be used, but no one doubts that it's a, that that if you're an observant Jew, it's a question worth asking, that it's at least possible to try to come to conclusions about it. So I think that's a bit of a red herring, you know, this notion that we simply live in a totally different world in terms of facts, like the invention of different sorts of weapons and different sorts of technologies. There might be better and, you know, less smart and more smart ways to apply originalist conclusions to modern facts. And again, I'm just channeling them.
I think the same thing, you know, when I listen to you guys, that, you know, it's sort of the Constitution, like, you know, if you say, like, well, what does it mean to be the United States, right? I mean, it's, you know, the Constitution sort of defines what that is, right? It's not like we're, you know, it's the land or the trees or something, right? I mean, that is what we are. And so, you know, you could say, well, you know, we want to continue sort of evolving it over time, but, you know, the United States was created as a thing. And then I guess the question is, how do you continue to have that thing in the face of new changes? And I really liked the quote from Brennan, by the way. I thought that was sort of, you know, directly responsive. So we got a bunch of questions right at the end. So let me take this one, which I think, because we're coming near the end, it's a good one. Keith Danish said, you know, so originalism is flawed. I think that all of you pointed out ways in which it's flawed. So what's a better way to keep the Supreme Court from acting as a roving constitutional convention?
Well, if I could start with that, I was saying before, it seems to me that the chief alternative, Samuel Alito replaced Sandra Day O'Connor on the court. And O'Connor was the one who in Casey sort of made up the rules about stare decisis. And if you believe as O'Connor did, I think O'Connor might not have voted for Roe v. Wade originally, but she decided that it was her role to uphold the essential core of Roe v. Wade because it was the court's work. And there wasn't a strong enough reason to throw away the court's, you know, work of at that point about 20 years just because she disagreed with it. So that was a constraint. You know, she was tying herself to the mast by saying, I have to look at the work of the other justices on the court. So Perry, you were using the word religion, and it seems to me that a lot of the authoritarian interpretation of the Constitution is also often compared to a religious text. And the idea that, you know, Justice Alito or Justice Scalia can look at the text and say, this is what that means. It's very much to me like a kind of religious fundamentalism. It's you have these authoritative interpreters who, you know, God tells them what it means and then they tell you. Admitting that there's uncertainty there and reasonable people can disagree. And therefore O'Connor says, I might not agree with the people who just said to the Supreme Court, this is what that means, but I'm going to yield to them because I'm now part of the court. I think the whole idea that there is, as you were saying, a magic bullet, that you look at those words and you look at the dictionary and look, and then you know what it means, as opposed to everybody is interpreting and there's always leeway.
I think so. I mean, the problem, I think Susan, one problem with that is that you're ascribing fundamentalist values to a Catholic court. So, if you actually push the religion, and it actually goes back, by the way, to Jefferson Powell's article that Perry was referring to earlier about the original understanding of original intent or whatever. Because I think Powell studied divinity on the side, so he was very sensitive to theological dimensions. So I'd be a little cautious about, you know, about making that equation.
I'd be very wary of analogizing this to religion.
If you think it's all policy,
religious traditions are full of argument, right?
Right.
If you read the Talmud, right, it's nothing but thousands of words of argument that really that almost never reach a conclusion. But in any event, there is this concern about discipline, right? There's this concern about not being a roving constitutional convention. And it's a legitimate concern. I think the three of us on the panel have sort of agreed that original public meaning originalism is not the magic bullet, right? You know, it's not necessarily more determinate or less prone to manipulation. But there are disciplinary tools that good judges use. And one of them is stare decisis. They're also just sort of, we have law students in law school for 3 years teaching them how to think like a lawyer. And we should expect judges to be able to do the same thing with some discipline. I suggest to anyone who is interested, just look at the website of the Judicial Committee of the Privy Council, which is a court that sits in London, made up of the same folks who also sit on the UK Supreme Court. But when they wear this different hat, they're not sitting as British judges, typically. They're sitting as the highest judges of a whole bunch of independent countries that for various political reasons, even though they're independent, still allow appeals up to the Judicial Committee. So they will be interpreting laws from Antigua and Barbados and different countries, different places. And it's, first of all, remarkable how rarely there's a dissent, even in very politically and ideologically controversial questions. And it's remarkable how disciplined they are in thinking through those questions. There was a recent set of opinions. I'm about to say, forget which two countries, but in both cases, there was a constitutional challenge regarding a right to a same-sex marriage. And in both cases, these British judges, who as a matter of personal opinion, I am 100% sure are committed to same-sex marriage, nevertheless interpreted both of these Caribbean constitutions as not providing a right to same-sex marriage. That in itself is just very interesting. And it was, right, and they sort of used some fairly standard legal techniques of interpretation to reach that conclusion. But what's even more interesting is one of the cases was 4-1. So there was one dissenting member of the court who said, yes, under, and again, I forget which constitution, under this given constitution in this given country, there turns out that there is a right to same-sex. So he dissented. In the other case, which was the opinion was released the same day, he wrote the majority opinion denying a right to same-sex marriage. So how could he do that? You know? Because he wasn't entirely tied to whatever underlying ideological beliefs he happened to have. He used various techniques of reading and various techniques of interpretation, not original public meaning, by the way, but various sort of techniques to read both constitutions. And in his case, he reached different conclusions. In the case of his four colleagues, they reached the same conclusion. But in either event, it's a remarkable institution. And if you look at constitutional courts in other countries, I think they put our court to shame in many ways because they often illustrate how it is possible to be disciplined and rigorous without trying to look for a magic bullet. You can really do that. And in the United States, we have this almost neurotic concern that unless we find the magic bullet, we're lost. And that's not how lawyers should be thinking. That's not the way lawyers should be conceiving of their own role in the world.
I'm sorry, Rhoda, I know you're about to wrap it up. Susan, I was just wondering, I know you answered questions. Somebody was very thankful for your comments about kind of women and their place and also asked about the ERA. Could you tell everybody else in maybe 30 seconds what you replied?
30 seconds. Okay, well, I think that the current
we have time.
Supreme Court, I'm sorry, Rhoda?
I said we have some time.
Okay, so we can handle 30 seconds. I think that the current approach, the magic bullet that a majority of justices think that they have, really do endanger the rights of women, as they did in Dobbs. But I think that at this point, the answers are in the state courts, and in political organizing. And then another question was about whether the ERA is about to finally be added to the Constitution as the 28th Amendment. And I was saying, I think not, because the current Republican House of Representatives is not likely to accept the delayed ratifications. And I asked the person who asked that question whether she thought that the ERA really should be a focal point for organization, or whether the organization should be in other areas. So this isn't really about originalism, which is why I just typed the answers. But I'm happy to hear other people's comments. Rhoda, any comments?
No, not at this moment. I was thinking about something, and I'll have comments another time, I'm sure. Lee, are there more questions?
There's one. We went through all of them except for one, and I don't know that I'm able to kind of correctly interpret this one. Came from Aaron Reyes. I could just read it and see if anybody else wants to just respond to it. It says, doesn't due process and freedom of the press long established meaning in English law even before they were put into the Constitution? I think it's, don't they have long established law before put in the Constitution of the United States? So originalism is not a new concept. And then it follows up with political power is not license to rebuild society according to some abstract untested scheme. It is a trust to be held by those who are mindful of both the value of what they have inherited, of their duties to their inheritors. For Burke, the idea of inheritance extended far beyond property to include language, manners, and morals, and appropriate responses to the human condition. So that was the last comment we got. If anybody has any response to that, please feel free.
Well, if I could start, I'm actually about to publish a book for Elgar Press. Rhoda invited us to advertise, called An Advanced Introduction to U.S. Civil Liberties. And one of the things that I talk about there is how the framers of the Constitution, including the Bill of Rights, were reacting to our English traditions in our heritage in some ways as positive, that there was some freedom of the press in terms of there was a disdain for prior restraint. But in other respects, the Constitution was written to reject English tradition. In England, for example, it was much easier to bring libel laws to complain, libel suits to complain that somebody had said something about you that was untrue. And the framers of the First Amendment, really, they didn't like that. They wanted to reform that. So there's a lot of history there about how the provisions of our Constitution are not what happened in England. And sometimes various justices have, again, had very different approaches to how to handle English traditions, because in some places the framers and presumably ratifiers perhaps really honored the English traditions, but in other places they were just looking to change. They wanted different rights and different approaches.
So Lee, have we?
Yeah, with that, we're actually, was another one just came in. People are just finding new things to ask. How does the concept of sovereign citizens fit into all of this?
It doesn't. I'll leave it at that. I mean, it's a modern myth of God knows what provenance.
Okay. At this moment, Rhoda, if you wrap it up.
Okay, I will. Thank you. Thank you so much. Listen, thank you, Perry. You're a good friend of NFRPP. We love having you. And thank you for being here. And Susan, now I know for sure why my granddaughter thinks you're one of her favorite professors.
Her granddaughter got an A, I'll tell you.
Yeah. Thank you so much. And Jack, it was a pleasure having you. I hope all three of you will return to us in the future, and we're going to have more topics related to this subject. So thank you very much. It was splendid, and I hope our audience enjoyed it. And thank you, Lee, for getting the questions accomplished. So to all of you still in the room, I see there's still some participants. We will be sending you a survey, and we hope you'll take the few minutes to complete it, because your comments help us to improve and to modify future programs. So thank you all, and come back in February. We'll be doing a program on anti-Semitism. So thank you very much again. Speakers, you were dynamite, and we appreciate it.
And thank you, Rhoda. Thank you for inviting us all.
Thank you.
So good night.
Good night.